The grace and peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with each of you this morning. Thank you so much. I appreciate that very much. I'm glad you're here. I want to welcome you to the worship service. If you're a guest visiting with us today, and I've met many today, I'm so glad that you're here. My name's Jay Smith. I'm pleased to welcome you on behalf of this church. I'm very, very biased. I think you've made a good choice. You could be a lot of places, but you've come to worship and to worship with us. And we're delighted, we're honored that you're here. We're thankful that you're here to be with us. If you are a guest, a couple of things I want you to be aware of especially. On the pews all around you, there are Get Connected cards. And that information that you put on there will give us an opportunity to reconnect with you about the ministries of our church. If you're looking for a church home, we'd love to share about the ministries of this church. Also, to my left, your right, these double doors after the service, a member of our hospitality team would love to give you a gift for being here today, and it has information related to the ministries as well. So we'd love to share that with you today if you're a guest as well. A lot of announcements in your bulletin. Please be aware of all of those. Jamie Unlin is our minister for students, and she has a very important announcement that's in your bulletin, but we want to accent a very special evening for this evening. So, Jamie?
I just wanted to take a minute to invite you all to the fellowship hall tonight. At 6 o'clock, we will be having our annual shareholders dinner. So our middle school mission team and our high school mission team will be there. They will be sharing stories about those trips, which would not be possible without your support. So if you prayed for us, if you attended a fundraiser, if you liked something on social media, if you did anything that had to do with one of those trips, you are invited to attend. And then there will also be a time set aside. Sarah Lowe is home. And as you all know, she has been, yeah.
That's her.
She has been gone for 11 months on a mission experience through the World Race Organization. And so we have set aside some time tonight at the shareholders dinner to allow her to share about her experience. And so I know many of you have supported her through that. So if you were a part of that, you are welcome to also attend because we want to give her the opportunity to share those experiences with you. So tonight, 6 o'clock in the fellowship hall, be there or be in the dark. So hope to see you there.
Don't be square, be there. Another announcement that's in your bulletin, the insert for the Believe. If you'll take that Believe insert out, today is the first day for signups, and you'll see baskets at the entrances, one over here to my left, to your right. All the entrances have a basket for you to register to be a part of the Believe Churchwide series that starts in September. But you can register your registration there and your intent to be a part of this. We're very excited. This is going to be for children, youth, and adults. It'll be intergenerational. We have actually a special word about the Believe series that we want to share with you this morning, if you'll watch this.
And if that's what God's after, is transform people who look more and more like Jesus every year, what did he do that enabled him to connect with God at such a level that the fruit of the Spirit would flow out of him? What if we did the same thing?
Its ability, the Believe series, to capture a range of spiritual journeys from mature to brand new, I think, is the power.
Unexpected and delightful benefit that we receive has been the development of and the use of a language in our congregation.
Now, we'll be able to assume that a certain percentage of our congregation always will have that base knowledge, having done Believe.
Students can come to their own conclusions and say, yes, this is something that's mine. It's not my parents, and it's not my pastors, it's not my youth leaders.
It was an opportunity for them to rehash, relook, reignite, and reevaluate what they believe they believe.
I love that about the Believe series, that from cradle to college into adulthood, Everyone is learning the same thing.
The fact that they've been going through the same beliefs, practices, virtues as my husband and I have been going through, and that my mom and dad, so their grandparents, have been going through, is we're holding a generational conversation around these really important things.
It's kind of created this intergenerational top to bottom line of sight dialogue that simply doesn't exist in a weekly sermon series.
The big exciting piece for me has been, it's no longer just my husband and I being on the same page as our kids, but also watching my kids integrate into conversations together. So watching my fourth grader and my second grader discuss who is God.
I love how this material doesn't shy away from some of these tougher subjects for maybe a 6 or 7 year old to understand.
In another curriculum, a student in a high school may go home with these doubts and have no one to talk to about it because mom and dad aren't learning the same thing. Through the Belief series, they've been able to talk to mom and dad and come back either with questions or statements of how their faith has changed as a result of what they talked about at home.
More parents are asking their kids what they learned after Sunday school, having been learning the similar kind of things themselves.
I've got two little granddaughters that I can look at their Sunday school stuff and say affectionately, well, Pop's talking about that in his small group on Sunday night.
This is what I learned. Oh, you learned the same thing? Well, I didn't think about this, about what we had learned. And it just kind of blew my mind, which is the greatest thing in youth ministry is when a kid just blows your mind. You're like, what? Wow, that was great.
And we always tell the kids, you know, ask your parents about this because they probably learned it too, and maybe they didn't. You can teach them something.
As little Lily would say, our 5-year-old, that's fun, Pop.
Excited about this. There are 4 time options for you. You'll see those on the insert, and today we begin registering. I hope you'll take advantage of that. We're all here for the same reason today. I'm so glad you've come. We're here to worship God, and let us worship the Lord.
As we begin our worship service this morning, I invite you to join in our call to worship. You can find that in your white hymnal on page 206 I will let you know that there are parts for parents, parts for youth, children, and young adults, we'll say, and then parts for everyone. I invite you to stand for our call to worship as we go to worship the Lord this morning. Page 206. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. The great God, he is the greatest king. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. And as we continue to sing for joy to the Lord this morning, I invite you to join in number 207. We have come to join in worship.
Standing, our affirmation of faith is printed in your bulletin this morning, an affirmation that the church has been sharing together faithfully for over 2,000 years, the Apostles' Creed. Let us join together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way of peace. Come into the brokenness of our lives and our land with your healing love. Help us, O God, to be willing to bow before you in true repentance and to bow to one another in real forgiveness. By the fire of your Holy Spirit, melt our hard hearts and consume the pride and prejudice which separate us. Fill us, O Lord, with your perfect love, which cast out our fear, and bind us together in that unity which you share with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As you're seated, let us all in the sanctuary of our own hearts confess our sins. None of us are perfect.
We all need God's redemption and forgiveness in our lives. So silently now, as the Spirit would lead you, let us pray. And there is no perfect church. There is no perfect congregation. And so we all need to pray together as a community of faith. Would you join with me in the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin? Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My sisters and brothers, hear the promises of God. God's forgiveness is as everlasting as the ages. God's mercy is as wide as the seas. Surely God will forgive our sins and restore a right spirit within us. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
We enjoyed this morning before worship a video of the children from the Foundry singing. And at the very end, they said thank you. And I hope you know that they are thanking you for all of the support you've already given the Foundry. The Foundry exists to level the playing field for children on the west end of Bowling Green. And we know that they most often come to school not ready for kindergarten. So the Foundry offers preschool in the morning and in the afternoon, and they offer after-school tutoring. And we partner with them through our volunteers, through our mentoring program at Dishman McGinnis, and in many other ways. If you would like to give financially to support all of these ministries at the Foundry, we invite you to do that as you come for communion. Any offerings you lay on the communion rail will go to support the ministries of the Foundry. This time, I would like our ushers to come forward to receive God's tithes and our offerings.
Oh,
It's nice to have the choir back in the loft, isn't it? They take July off, and we always look forward to when they're back. Friends, in the month of August, we're going to be looking at the parables of Jesus, some of his parables. Since we're all getting ready to go back to school, or some of us are, this new series is Back to School with Jesus, Life Lessons from His Parables. So we'll be looking at these. As you probably are aware, Jesus taught his disciples, his students, through parables. These were stories taken from real life. They're either about nature or business or family. And they're instructive, not just so that we might spend eternity somewhere, but they're instructive for what Jesus referred to as the kingdom of God, which is at hand, here and now. And so they're instructive to us to help build the world the way Jesus wants it built. And so our first parable today is Luke chapter 14, verses 15 to 24. It's the parable of the great banquet. For those of you who are able, would you please stand and honor the reading of the gospel? Let us all go back to school now with Jesus through his parables. Listen now for the word of the Lord. When one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." And Jesus replied,
"A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent a servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.'
But they all alike began making excuses. The first said,
'I've just bought a field, and I must go and see about it. Please excuse me.'
Another said,
'I've just bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me.'
Still another said,
'I just got married, so I can't come.'
The servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant,
'Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.'
'Sir, what you have ordered has been done, but there is still room.'
Then the master told his servant,
'Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet.'"
This is the word of God for the people of God. And thanks be to God. You can be seated. Well, I went to my 35th high school reunion last night in Madisonville, North Hopkins, Fighting Maroons, class of 81. Nothing. I thought Jamie would. What's that? I don't look old enough to be 35. Thank you for saying that. That is wonderful. I appreciate that. No, I went to the 35th reunion last night in Madisonville, and I want you to know I had a great time, and I want you to know why I had a great time. And it might not be some of the things some of you are thinking that you shouldn't be thinking, why I would have had a great time at my reunion. I had a great time because at the reunion, there were people there. If I could have made the list out myself of who I would hope would be there for the reunion, they were there. All the people that I was hoping to see, hoping to talk with, they were there. And I was able to see some people that I had not seen in 15, 20 years. I went to high school with people that I went to kindergarten with. And we were able to reminisce and to connect and reconnect. The people there last night were, if you will, my A-list. They were the people that I hung out with, and I was hoping to see. They were my people. And so the gathering there was a party because it was a party of people that I was comfortable with and that I knew and that I grew up with. Now, the parable this morning, if you noticed, is just the opposite. The host invites to a great banquet all these that he has invited. And these are people of his own status and standing.
The host is a man who is well off. We know he's wealthy because he has a banquet. We know he can afford a banquet. We know that he moves in and out of with people who are of means because they buy land and they buy oxen. He invites people, which was not unusual. We do it, they did it then. Inviting people to the same standing socioeconomically, his peers. In that day and time, it was unheard of to invite to a dinner or a party anyone who was not the same status or honor as you. It did not cross socioeconomic boundaries. And I didn't realize this until I was studying this parable, but there would have been a double invitation in that day. The people would have been invited, and they would have already accepted the invitation. And so the servant goes out just to gather them in. They've already said they would be there, and so the servant goes out and says, "Everything's ready. Come, gather at the table. The banquet is ready." And so the host, it's his worst nightmare, because the writer here shares with us, Jesus shares here, that nobody is going to come. And they make excuses. One says, "I just bought a field and I must go see it." Another, "I've bought five yoke of oxen and I have to go try them out." And another just gets married and is unable to attend. Now, we might think all of these reasons, those are reasonable reasons to not attend. But the pain of it is because they had already accepted the invitation, and now, at the last minute, they are refusing to come to the banquet. Now, we might not realize in that day and time, nobody would have bought a piece of property without looking at it first. We wouldn't do that now. I mean, who among us would buy a house that we've never seen? Who among us would buy a tractor or a car or a combine without ever trying it out first? And so what we have here in Jesus' time, as he shared this parable, they would have been saying to themselves, these excuses are absurd. What they're doing is making an excuse to Jesus that makes no sense at all. Basically, they're smoking him. They're lying to him. Now, the third excuse, getting married, I believe those that think that this would have been a parable, this village that they would have been gathered in, they would have known there would never have been a great banquet held in conjunction with in proximity to a wedding. And so again, this excuse makes no sense. Now, this is magnified. The honor and the dishonor of the man is magnified. The shame of the man hosting the dinner is magnified. Why is his shame magnified? In Jesus' time, it was not uncommon to have three characters within a story. You remember the Good Samaritan? The Good Samaritan fell by the wayside, and the priest came and didn't do anything, and the Levite came and didn't do anything. The expectation, the third character in most of these stories, the third character reverses things and does something. But in Jesus, in this parable here, what people would have been expecting, that the third character, he's going to come, he's going to accept the invitation, he's going to show, even the third character has an excuse and doesn't come. Nobody comes. It magnifies the shame and the dishonor placed on this man. Keep in mind, in the Mediterranean world, it's a shame and honor-based culture. Even today, in geopolitical kinds of issues, world leaders have to think about how can we do something in this area of the world where we do not shame the people in that part of the world. It's a shame-based culture. And so the host, because the people on his A-list aren't coming to the banquet, what does he do? And in Jesus' time, the anticipation would have been, well, he might find some people of greater standing just to show those that didn't come, hey, I'll show you. These are the people coming to the banquet now. Every parable has a moment where there's a shock, there's a reversal, there's something that's unexpected. And sometimes we don't understand what the shock is because we don't understand the world that these stories came out of very well. I don't, you don't. And so we don't understand what the shock factor is. But in this story, what this man does would have been unheard of. He says, those that aren't coming, that were invited, he now sends his servant out into the streets, and he invites who? He invites the poor, the crippled, the lame, the unwanted. And his servant comes back, and his servant says, we've done what you've asked, but there's more room. And get this, God always has more room, and God wants there to be a full house. And so he says to his servant, you go outside the city, go into the country alleys and bring in so that my house will be full. Now, maybe you knew this. I didn't know this. In Jerusalem, the city gates were closed in the evening. And so the people out in the country, they were never permitted to stay inside the walls of the city after night. These were the homeless. These were the dispossessed. These were the unwanted, the untouchables, if you will. And they weren't permitted to stay inside the city. And so you'll notice the servant says, I will compel them. Why does he have to compel them? He has to compel them because they probably think, you're setting us up. We can't go into the gates of the city. We can't be there in the evening. They'll close the gates. You're going to put us in jail. They don't know what's going on. He has to compel them to come to the banquet. The man's honor and the shame that they have placed on him, he does the complete unexpected. He reverses who is to come to the banquet. Bless you. And I meant to tell you before I read the parable, at the beginning of chapter 14, who is Jesus having dinner with? Who is he meeting with? He's in the house of a Pharisee, and he's having dinner with Pharisees. Who were the Pharisees? Pharisees, we sometimes paint them with one broad brush. We think they were just judgmental and sort of narrow-minded, but the Pharisees, they were the people who wanted to follow the law, the Torah, to the letter. They were the persons who loved. We would say they were the persons who were serious about the Bible. They would be the ones signing up for the belief study, right? And I don't know about, because they love the Bible. And I don't know about you, I love the Bible, and I'm gonna be facilitating belief. Why? Because I want to know what the Bible has to do with the world in which we live. And so these are the people that Jesus is eating with, but these are the people, his message to them is, you are rejecting, you are the ones who think you are going to have the choice seats at the table, and you are refusing to extend the invitation. Jesus is eating with people who would have thought in their own hearts and minds, if anybody's going to be at that grand banquet, we're going to be there. Now, I don't know about you, but that scares me to death, because I know who I am in these stories. I would be a Pharisee because I love the Bible. I want to know what the Bible has to do with how we live our lives in the world. But the parable shares with us that this great banquet, the table, is for everybody. For everybody. The invitation is to everyone to come and to be at the Master's table. The only thing keeping us from it is any excuse that we might make in our own lives. But the table is for all. Which raises a couple of questions, at least for me. One question is, have we taken our place at the table? God's always inviting. God wants each and every one of us to be at that table, that grand banquet. Have we taken our place? The other question is, are we okay with all the other people that God has invited to the table? It's like that old joke. You know the old joke about the man who goes to heaven and Peter, St. Peter's showing him around heaven, and the Methodists are over here and the Baptists are over here. And if you're a former Church of Christ, forgive me, but this is the way I've heard the joke told. And you come to this other door and St. Peter says, shh, be real quiet. The Church of Christ are here. They think they're the only ones here. It's a bad joke. It's an old joke. But maybe some of us Methodists think we're going to be, you know, just fill in the blank with whatever name you choose. Some of us think we're going to be the only ones there, only ones at the table. And Jesus just shatters that whole notion and says, everybody, the invitation is for everybody. And the question is, how do we view those? What is our attitude to the way Jesus extends the invitation? How do we view persons? And how do we treat people that Jesus clearly invites? If you want to know why our church, why we have a ministry, why we would open our building up across the street during the winter months as a warming center for the homeless in this community, it's because Jesus' invitation is to everyone. If you want to know why we hand out groceries during the week, and this past Wednesday, persons came in and we gave out more money than we should have, but we helped people who were struggling in this community. If you want to know why the sign out front says everybody is welcome, that's Jesus' invitation. And it's one of the reasons I love Jesus. Jesus looked at everybody. Every single man, every single woman, every single human being with the heart and the compassion of God. And the invitation is for all. That's why I love Communion Sunday. This table here, communion, when we gather for communion, this table points to the grand table, the grand banquet. That's what it points to. It's not just a communion table for us here today. It reminds us that there is a table that God has set for you and for me and every human being, and the invitation is for them to come. Last night at the reunion, Maria Tomorrow is a member of our class, and she's the one that has organized these reunions through the years. And Maria wasn't even born in Madisonville. She's a Yankee of all things. I think she's from New York. But she is the one that through the years has called us together and invited us back every 5 years. We get together every 5 years for our reunion. And Maria's the one, and last night about midway through the festivities, they told the DJ just to settle down, and some had planned this. I didn't know they were going to do it. I'm so glad they did, but they had gotten a bouquet of roses for Maria, and they had gotten a tiara for her, and they placed the tiara on her head. It was like the Miss Universe pageant, and she was just in tears, and after she stopped crying, they gave her the microphone and let her share, and Maria said this. She said, I will keep doing this as long as you all keep coming. I'll keep doing this. Friends, the invitation from God is the exact same. God's invitation is to us, and it's always extended to us. God invites you and God invites me to this grand banquet today. Won't you come? Will you come? Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the gift of your invitation to each of us and to every woman and child and man and youth on the face of the earth. We thank you, O God, that you invite us to this grand banquet that we are reminded of as we commune together this morning. Holy God, bless this time as we eat at your table. May it remind us of that great banquet that we will share someday with you in eternity. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. He is our brother and he is our friend. Amen. Please turn to page 15 in the front of your United Methodist hymnal for our order for Holy Communion. Page 15.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. In the beginning, your Spirit moved over the face of the waters. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed and your love remained steadfast, your Spirit, O God, came upon prophets and teachers, anointing them to speak your word. And so, O God, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. At his baptism in the Jordan, your Spirit descended upon him and declared him your beloved Son. With your Spirit upon him, he turned away the temptations of sin. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always, baptizing us with the Holy Spirit and with fire, as on the day of Pentecost. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he broke it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and he gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." On the day you raised him from the dead, he was recognized by his disciples in the breaking of the bread, and in the power of your Holy Spirit, your church has continued in the breaking of bread and the sharing of the cup. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us, O God, the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus has always taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." This time I want to invite those that will be assisting and serving to come forward as they make their way to the front. I would just remind all of you that we practice open communion in the United Methodist Church. We do not exclude anyone from this table. You do not have to be a Methodist. You do not have to be a member of this church. Everyone is welcome to come and to receive the gifts of God's grace. May the body of Christ broken for you. Carry the body of Christ broken for you. Surely the body of Christ broken for you.
Friends, we're thankful for all those that assist in communion. I meant to mention before we started receiving communion, Gary Chapman, who's a retired United Methodist pastor, now with our church, was assisting. If you're wondering, who is that man up there serving communion today? Gary is a longtime mentor and friend of mine, and he flunked retirement the first time, but this is going to stick this time. So, but Gary, we're thankful for your ministry among us now here at State Street.
And as we close our service of communion this morning, I invite you to turn in your red hymnal to number 620 as together we join in singing One Bread, One Body.
My sisters and brothers, go from this place. We are one body. We are one table, a table that's been set for all to come. Go from this place. There are people in this world that you will see that do not yet know that God has invited them and has a place for them at the table. Go to share that great news with them. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, go in peace.